thank you very much for showing up. More so, thank you to the organizers, Luis Ciro, my friend, for inviting me. I'm fascinated by this country. I'm trying to learn history. And all physicians should do either be photographers or art lovers or historians. So I try to do everything. But this is a great place to be, and we look forward to seeing Cartagena. The lecture I've been asked to give this morning is on new lesions of the pituitary. I'm mixing it a little bit also with unusual lesions of the pituitary and trying to put those lesions into perspective. So we'll get going here. Do I have my advance click? Ah, there it is. Thank you so much. Okay. Now, in terms of cellar lesions, just to make a point, the cella is a remarkable area. There is embryologically much going on. There's a remarkably difficult and complex multi-part anatomy. And so necessarily, the lesions that occur there are numerous. And this is just a list. I don't expect you to read it. I just want to make the impression that you can expect many things in the cellar region that you might not suspect. There are, in the way of tumors, also very rare tumors. They're episodically, they're described, and you can read them for yourselves. But they include neuroectodermal tumors, nerve sheath lesions, hemopoietic lesions, mesenchymal tumors. So the spectrum is very large. And it's a challenge for pathologists because in this limited space, you sometimes don't get much tissue. So you have to optimize. And for the pathologists here, my suggestion to you is try not to freeze your tissues unless you have a lot. Do smears as much as possible. Never embed everything. Always keep a little something in formalin. It doesn't need to be glutaraldehyde. Formalin is perfectly good if you need EM. And if you have a specific interest, freeze a little piece away. Now, just in terms of pituitary adenomas, to give you a tiny bit of perspective here, about half of them are macroadenomas, defined as tumors larger than a centimeter. About a third are non-functional, and they show up with mass effects, headaches, visual disturbances, hypopituitarism. And of those, most are gonadotrophs, null cell adenomas, silent tumors that you would expect to be functional, like silent corticotrophs. But there are also plurihormonal tumors of unusual types that can be silent or functional. But the one that we'll be mentioning this morning as a relatively new thing is the silent subtype 3 adenoma. And the reason for this is not because it's brand new, but we're getting more and more of an insight into the nature of this tumor. Dr. Horvath, the wife and co-worker of our colleague Kalman Kovacs, is an electron microscopist. And she is superb. Unfortunately, she's unique. There are very few people that are able to use electron microscopy in a really creative way. And this is an ultrastructural entity. There are rough clinical correlates that bring up the differential, light microscopic features that may make you think of the diagnosis. But when all is done, you need electron microscopy to confirm it. But it's an important adenoma. Okay? It's like acidophil stem cell tumors, aggressive growth hormone and prolactin-producing lesions where you need EM for confirmation. And it has clinical implications. So she had a series of some 20 patients. They were all macroadenomas, often invasive. They are largely non-functioning. And in the two sexes, you got two different clinical pictures at times. In females, they could mimic prolactin-producing tumors, so pseudoprolactinomas, with prolactin levels usually in the range of stalk effect. But we know now that this is also active tumoral production of prolactin. In males, and we don't understand why males are selected, you may have growth hormone hyperproduction. But regardless, they're aggressive. And because of the elevation of prolactin, there's a tendency to want to treat them with bromocriptine. They do not respond. So this is clinically and pathologically an important lesion. It's unusual, but that doesn't make it unimportant. Here is an additional series from our own institution, from Mayo Clinic, 27 patients. Not much sex predilection. They tend to occur in adults, patients 18 and over. And the majority, 75%, are non-functioning. The rest do function. And they can make for acromegaly, as I mentioned to you, in males, and clinical prolactin excess that's manifest most often in females. Okay? One of the patients actually had a carcinoma, a tumor of this kind that metastasized. It's exquisitely rare, and it was not in the series. And you can see here the prolactin elevations in three cases were over 150 nanograms per ml. Growth hormone elevations in 5 of 17 patients studied, greater than 5 nanograms, and IGF-1 elevations in a similar proportion. So deficiencies, though, were present in the majority. And when we looked at the light microscopy, the main thing was a good proportion of the patients had cytologically atypical tumors. Large nuclei, irregular nuclei, prominence of nucleoli. I mean, mitotic activity. Definitely things that make you worry. And when the immunohistochemistry was done, you can see that growth hormone, prolactin, and TSH were frequently found. Now, that's interesting because that combination is also the combination we see in acromegalic patients. But there was one other thing, the occasional finding of ACTH. So it's a peculiar process, and because of that mixture, we thought there must be a mixture of transcription factors underlying the production of those hormones. And it was true. The transcription factors included PIT1, which subserves growth hormone, prolactin, TSH, and NeuroD1 that underlies the production of ACTH. So this is a tumor that is rather schizophrenic. It has two different drivers. It has drivers for differentiation toward what we usually see in growth hormone adenomas plus NeuroD1. So that may be an explanation not necessarily of the aggressiveness, but of the peculiar immunophenotype. And here's an example, and this is a very standard example, not selected to be particularly atypical. But for the pathologists in the audience, this will get your eye. There are large nuclei, irregular folded nuclear membranes, and prominence of nucleoli. Mitoses can also be seen in these tumors. And the ultrastructure, remember I told you, you need EM to make a firm diagnosis of this tumor. And here you see that the cells are often sizable and somewhat elongate, polar cells. They have a very prominent Golgi complex. That's a massive Golgi complex. They have nuclear inclusions called spheroids, which are not specific but frequently seen. They have abundance of rough endoplasmic reticulum. And they also have smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So when do we consider this diagnosis clinically? Well, when we have a non-functioning tumor, large and invasive. You say, well, we see a lot of those. Cytologically atypical. Don't see too many of those, and plurihormonal. And if you're lucky, you may get ACTH in the mix. But if you have a tumor making growth hormone, prolactin, and TSH, plus the atypia, and possibly no acromegaly, non-functioning status, think of this diagnosis. And this is just to show you the smooth endoplasmic reticulum in these tumors as well. And one last thing, that was a slide out of order, and that is that the rough endoplasmic reticulum tends to encircle mitochondria. It's a highly distinctive, very unusual feature. Okay, so in the Mayo Clinic series, what happened to these patients? Well, we had persistent tumor in 50%. That's no surprise. A recurrence in 2/3. That's quite frequent, and it's not unexpected. And the patients had other things as well, pituitary deficiencies, only 1/3 of which resolved. So it's very much like gonadotrophs. Any other macroadenoma that compresses the gland will leave you with the same probability of reestablishing endocrine balance. So that's the silent corticotroph adenoma, silent adenoma subtype 3. So just kind of remember that. There's a nice little literature on the subject now, and it's really coming into focus. And we're understanding more. I think we still have not explained why this tumor is more aggressive than usual. But I think we've explained why it has the unusual phenotype, immunophenotype. Okay. Now, there are tumors that arise in the pituitary that really don't look like adenohypophyseal cells and don't function, and frankly look rather glial or mesenchymal. They're spindled cells, epithelioid cells, quite a pleomorphic process. And this is the lesion. The original series was published by Federico Roncaroli, a friend of mine and a colleague of our group. There were 5 patients. They were all adults, and they have always been adults now. We have some 25 cases. They're all adults. They have panhypopituitarism, and because of their size, occasional visual field defects. So the imaging is like a non-invasive macroadenoma with supracellular extension. But the morphology is distinctive. Spindle and epithelioid cells that have granular cytoplasm. Okay? Scant mitoses. And the immunotype is rather nonspecific. Vimentin, which is not a surprise. Epithelial membrane antigen, S100 protein, and galectin. But galectin is not specific. We're finding now that something called annexin 1 is a far more reliable marker of these cells, which we believe to be folliculostellate cells in nature. And there's good publications recently by Dr. Horvath to suggest exactly that. With gross total removals, these patients do very well, no recurrence. With subtotal removals, you can expect recurrence. There are now a few cases, 2 or 3, that are mitotically active that have recurred and invaded bone in a destructive manner. So it does have a range, but not to frank malignancy. None have ever metastasized. Okay? And they're very, very distinctive. And these are the 2 cases reported at the time that had recurrences, osseous invasion and mitoses, as well as increased levels of MIB1 staining. You'll remember that MIB1, same thing as Ki-67, is a useful marker for proliferating cells. Here's an example from the first series. Anyone in the audience dealing with pituitaries would say, it's an adenoma, take him to surgery. But the morphology is unusual. They're large pink cells. They spindle. They may be plump and epithelioid. They frequently have areas of chronic inflammation. And at higher power, you see the granular cytoplasm that is due not to secretory granules, but to mitochondria. Okay? That's what makes them such. And here you see the spindling, the more plump epithelial cells. And you'll see, not epithelial, but epithelioid. And you see also the degenerative nuclear atypia. And there's the epithelial membrane antigen, the S100 protein. They, of course, are positive for antibodies directed against mitochondria on the left, and galectin-3. But as I said, galectin-3 is very ubiquitous in tumors of the nervous system, so you cannot rely on it. It's simply a part of the immunophenotype, just like vimentin. Vimentin is probably one of our least specific markers, but it's very useful with respect to proving that your tissue is immunoviable. The tissue is good. Okay? So annexin 1 is also positive, and it's also seen in the normal posterior pituitary and also in the folliculostellate cells on the right in the anterior lobe. And of course, ultrastructurally, they are full of mitochondria. So that's the spindle cell oncocytoma. Okay? Now, what about gliomas? You say, well, now, wait a minute, we're talking about pituitaries here. This is true, but remember, the pituitary has the other half, the posterior lobe. We're somewhat in love with the anterior lobe because there's such clinical and functional and morphologic diversity. But the posterior lobe is really very important. The interesting thing about the posterior lobe is that it has really, for practical purposes, only one cell type, and it's glial. The pituicyte that helps shroud the axons from the hypothalamus is a glial cell. In primitive creatures, it's ependymal. In humans, it's more often astrocytic, with only rare examples of ependymal differentiation. So, but what do we have then? We certainly have hypothalamic tumors that can make their way into the posterior lobe via the stalk. And this occurs with pilocytics. So when you see a tumor from the cella or posterior lobe that looks pilocytic, just be sure you know what the imaging looks like. Does this patient also have a hypothalamic mass coming down? Infiltrative astrocytomas of the sort that we are all afraid of, grades 2, 3, and 4, glioblastoma, those tumors do occur in the midline, in the hypothalamus, and do descend into the posterior lobe. But there are also, within the pituitary, tumors that can be linked or viewed as being glial. And that includes the pituocytoma, granular cell tumor, that's really an old friend, everybody from medical school remembers them, but we don't know or aren't aware that ependymomas also occur there. And here you see the typical hypothalamic pilocytic tumor, localized macrocystic. Spindle cells with lots of filaments, that gives you the red color, and then these beautiful Rosenthal fibers. Very, very distinctive. The other part of that same tumor, the other phase, and it's often biphasic, is this loose textured microcystic pattern with granular bodies, and you see them here. So it's easy to make the diagnosis. But like everything else, and this is directed to the pathologists here, but really to everyone else too, you're functioning as a team. You have the endocrinologists, the neurosurgeons, the radiologists, and the pathologists. And they're like four parts of a cube. They fit together. And you have to know each other's information, you have to share information, and you have to be creative together. And if you're working alone, unaware of any of this, you're going to be a poorer clinician, and the pathologist is going to be a dangerous individual who doesn't know the clinical setting, the imaging. You don't want that. Okay? So this is what I have for pilocytics, and they're very vascular. That's why they're so contrast enhancing. And here you see a subset of them, and they do occur in the hypothalamus. And these are particularly aggressive pilocytic variants called pilomyxoid astrocytoma. And the thing that makes them so unusual is they can grow rather quickly, and they can seed the axis. Okay? So this is a tumor that's just becoming apparent to the neuropathology community. So it is a new lesion. And here you see one. You say, well, yeah, it's loose textured. It has spindling. It has a mucoid background. It even has some perivascular rosette-like structures. It's GFAP positive. And GFAP is a wonderful marker for glial cells. And so everything is there for the diagnosis of a pyloid-type tumor, but without Rosenthal fibers, without granular bodies. That's very important. And on rare occasion, there have been examples of this tumor that over time turn into perfect pilocytics. So the relationship between the two is very firm. And here you see the overall survival of these patients. And you can see that the purple line here, the pylomyxoids, do much less well than pilocytic astrocytomas. Now, the anaplastic astrocytomas, as I mentioned to you, and this is a case from Dr. Kovacs. This is an example where the, actually, this is, no, this I think might be one of mine, but that's beside the point. We have a diffuse infiltrative astrocytoma of the ordinary type, and a case like it where, and this is the morphology of it, and in another case like it, you see it moved into the posterior lobe, completely replaced, and notice it even had the ability to invade the anterior lobe. So astrocytic tumors occur in the pituitary, and here's the extension right in among the anterior pituitary cells. There's remnants of anterior pituitary, and here the glial cells. But what about pituocytomas then? They're glial, okay, let's talk about them. Here's a series that is from a friend of mine, Dan Bratt, of 9 cases that we worked on. They tended to be adult patients again. Unlike pilocytics, they tend to be children, kids, adolescents. So here you have that. Suprasellar extension, visual disturbances, everything you would expect from a non-functioning, continuously growing, but indolent tumor. Okay? The morphology is very distinctive. I won't read it to you. And the recurrence rate is only seen with subtotal resections. Gross totals, they're cured. And here are some examples where there have been gross total removals and alive and well, despite suprasellar extension, despite radiation therapy, some of them have required, they still have a good prognosis, and recurrences are late. So here's what the imaging looks like on an example. Seems to fill the cella. Okay. Some of them clearly go up into the stalk, which is not surprising. Here's another example. Really look like pituitary adenomas, really. And again, you say, oh my, another spindle cell tumor. This is true. But remember that spindle cell oncocytomas are actually anterior lobe tumors, presumably are derived from folliculostellate cells. These are posterior lobe tumors derived from or differentiating toward pituocytes. And they are GFAP positive. They may have a rather storiform pattern, a term meaningful to pathologists. They are GFAP reactive in this additional example. So they're something to think about. They're exquisitely rare. They're associated with diabetes insipidus, and that's not a surprise. They have no function in and of themselves. They're totally non-functional tumors. Now, what about granular cell tumors? This will be just a, and they're gone, because we know this lesion, but it's rare. Here you see a classic example, these little lobules of large cells with granular cytoplasm and nuclei that are pushed to one side. And they're very PAS positive. Lysosomes, which these cells are filled with, are PAS positive. So it's very easy to make a distinction between the granular appearance of the spindle cell oncocytoma, which is mitochondrial. They are negative for PAS. But the granular cell tumors with their lysosome content are positive for PAS. Okay. cellar ependymoma, just to let you know, I mentioned it, it occurs. We really should have mentioned it and put it right ahead of or behind the pituocytoma. They're exquisitely rare. They are also probably pituocyte-derived. You can see how rare they are when people even mention that one example was in a horse. All right, so you're not going to be seeing these. Don't be looking for them in your next case. Here are the authors that have reported them, and we know too little to really characterize these lesions, but they do cause posterior lobe dysfunction. And here you see an example that was occupying the cella, rather sizable, and the thing at the light microscopic level were these little microlumens. That's a distinctive feature of ependymal tumors. And here you see the epithelial membrane antigen that stains these little lumina as either dots or spheres. And at the ultrastructural level, you see the complex ribbon-like junctions of ependymoma. Okay. Processes, ribbon junctions, and microlumens containing cilia and microvilli. Now, the last thing I want to talk about, and I have just about enough time, 10 minutes, is the pituitary blastoma. This you may not have heard of. There's only one case reported so far. We have now found three additional cases and probably two more in the literature. And so a picture is coming together. This first patient was a 13-month-old Korean female. That already should get your interest. Infantile tumors of the anterior pituitary are exquisitely rare. So the chances that it's something like this are pretty high because pituitary adenomas in infants are very, very rare, and they tend to be ACTH-producing. Well, so is this lesion, okay? But it's different. Okay, and I won't take you through the rest of this. It was a 3.5-centimeter lesion, and there was focal necrosis noted grossly. This is quite massive on the scale of cellular tumors. Remember again, this child is only 13 months. This probably began in utero. And it has a distinctive appearance, sort of not really true lobules, but aggregates of cells, areas of necrosis, a distinct border with brain, because this is GFAP, and it's not really invasive. A tumor composed of big pink cells and smaller cells, such as these, plus glandular structures like these. And it's positive for ACTH. And here's that NeuroD1, the transcription factor for ACTH-producing cells. It happened to be making a little bit of growth hormone, but nothing else. And as you might expect, the PIT1, the transcription factor for growth hormone, prolactin, and TSH, was also there. There was alpha subunit, which is a very early thing to be seen in the anterior lobe. It's one of the earliest things to be demonstrated. And so here you see the transcription factors done. NeuroD1, PIT1, and a variety of other things were negative. No real good staining for cells that would normally help make gonadotrophs. They come later in the sequence. They were not represented. And in all of the tumors to date that we've been managed to get together, it's ACTH in all of them, and rarely anything more, one case with GH. Okay, folliculostellate cells were a part of this process, and here you can see the lumina that they make. They're also present in the normal pituitary, but these were among the small cells. Okay, then there was secretory differentiation in some of these that actually showed some granules, and we know that folliculostellate cells can contain granules. They are related to the anterior lobe cells. And at the in the large cells, the big secretory pink cells, we had typical variation in electron density of ACTH granules and intermediate filaments. That's classic corticotrophic differentiation. And in addition, a few cells showed the features of growth hormone cells. So we have a complex little tumor here that is clearly embryonal in a sense, or primitive, and it makes us think of Rathke's cleft cyst, illustrated here in a fetal pituitary, where all this differentiation has not yet really occurred. And there you see the human fetal pituitary starting to show secretory differentiation. And these are probably ACTH cells. So what supported the idea that this might be a blastoma? You say, what is a blastoma? Well, there are tumors of the liver, of the kidney, of the lung, that recapitulate developmental components of those organs. And this is very much a similar thing. Well, we had Rathke-type epithelium, the large epithelial structures. We had these poorly formed acinar structures. We had an ultrastructural resemblance to fetal pituitary. We had ACTH and then a little bit of GH would be an extremely rare combination in ordinary pituitary adenoma. Then we had, of course, the thing that really makes it distinctive, Rathke's epithelium. And we looked for chromosomal abnormalities and could find none. Now, since then, we've seen some more. We're just finishing the paper. Dr. Kovacs just went through editing it on three cases of a 9-month-old, 13-month-old, 2-year-old. Males, females, we can't say anything about it, but they're macroadenoma size. And they have increase in ACTH in almost all cases. These two are from the literature. They're old cases called pituitary adenomas. They're not. And we're trying to get those. And some of the patients end up with clinical features of Cushing's disease. So there tends to be function. Here's case one of these three examples we now have in hand. And you can see again, patches of secretory cells, small cells surrounding them, a little higher power view of the same thing. These appear relatively undifferentiated appearing. Here you see the glandular structures, sort of the Rathke epithelium. They're chromogranin or synaptophysin positive. Only in the secretory cells, you'll notice the little cells and the glands are negative. Keratin is pretty much strongest in the little primitive epithelial structures. No surprise. But because it's ACTH, you have a little bit of staining in the cells because ACTH cells normally are keratin positive. There's another example. Then annexin, which is a folliculostellate cell marker, is positive in some of these smaller cells between lobules. P27, which generally goes along with a proliferation suppressed population, is very positive in the secretory cells, and the reverse, P53, is very positive in the smaller cell component. So you have a really truly biphasic lesion here. There's the Ki67 on that example. Now this one, our case two, is different. It has up to 10 or 12 or more mitoses for 10 high power fields. Very different. So it's very frightening. Here are those primitive glands. There is necrosis. MIB1 labeling index up to 60%. Very different from the first one, but in every other way, other than the anaplasia, identical. Then the last one is a case actually previously published, but now further studied from Korea also. Two Korean cases, maybe there's something there. And this one, in addition to all the other features, which were classic, also had some mucin-producing epithelium in some follicles. All right, but it also had a little bit of S100 and GFAP, which is generally not present early on. It's something that comes along later. So this is the exception to the rule. And so when do you, and the MIB1 labeling index in this, was maybe 1%. So we seem to have aggressive lesions, and all of these are invasive. Aggressive lesions with high proliferation and extensive lesions with low proliferation. So there's probably an element of grading that can go on. And here you see, what makes you think of it clinically? Infantile presentation, macro size, invasion, ACTH excess, with or without Cushing's. Okay? So you say, well, you know, that doesn't tell me much. That could still be simply an adenoma. But I'll tell you that pituitary adenomas in infants making ACTH are more rare than this. Okay? So then the pathologic point of view. They have folliculostellate cells. They have secretory cells that make ACTH primarily. Rathke's epithelium, sometimes simply undifferentiated little cells akin to blastema in blastomas, and rarely even goblet cells. Now, how that little extra goblet cells thing fits into the spectrum developmentally, we do not know. But it's an interesting lesion, and I thought you should be aware of it. That's my presentation. So you've been introduced to a pretty much new tumor. Any questions?